Well, good morning and welcome back to this session of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. We have now with us Paul Wheelhouse, Minister for Business, Innovation and Energy. Welcome to you. And with the Minister are the advisors Chris Stark, who's Director of Energy and Climate Change for the Scottish Government, Mike King, who's Economic Advisor, Sue Kearns, Head of Electricity, and Cathy Robertson, who is Head of the Heat Energy Efficiency and Low Carbon Investment Unit. So welcome to all of our guests today. Minister, if I might start just by asking a question about emissions reductions, and I think the planned emissions reductions to 2032 in the transport sector, I think is the planned reduction of 31%, and of course emissions are a big issue in terms of the health of the country. If we think of areas in the country such as St John's Road and Christorphan here in Edinburgh, one of the most polluted roads in the country. My question is the target set out a realistic one, and how will that be achieved?
Well, it's a very important area. I think, first of all, I'd acknowledge and thank you for the invitation to appear before the committee today, that that transport is an area that we acknowledge we have to make more progress in, and so we are trying to work to deliver effective solutions, and using the Times model that colleagues can provide some technical background on, we have been able to look at what are cost-effective pathways to deliver our emissions reduction targets for up to 2032 and indeed beyond to 2050. And in the case of transport, we know there has been a great degree of challenge in the past, in that with emissions reductions and vehicle emission standards have improved dramatically in terms of the motor vehicle manufacturing trade, but that has to some extent has been offset by increased usage of vehicles. So in short, people have had more efficient engines, they have driven further than they had done previously, and that has cancelled out to some extent the efficiencies that have been generated in terms of the technology itself. So we have to look at alternatives to deliver transport emission savings, and one of the key ways in which we can do that is obviously to decarbonise the vehicle fleet themselves. So if people are continuing to drive, they're doing it in such a way as it's not adding to significantly to emissions as current vehicles do. So hence there's a lot of emphasis in the strategy around the electrification of the vehicle fleet. That's not to ignore the very important work we're doing in regards to promoting hydrogen within Scotland. So we're doing excellent work both in Fife, at Fife Energy Park, and also in Orkney with a project which is taking place in the EMEC, European Marine Energy Centre, in partnership with local interests there, to develop use of hydrogen both for storage but also in use in vehicles, in case of Orkney, in case of the ferry fleet, but in Fife in respect of council vehicles, Kangoo vehicles, transits, and indeed refuse collection vehicles. So we are doing a lot of work pioneering with new technologies, alternatives to diesel and petrol, but equally we're keen to advance the uptake of electric vehicles in the Scottish fleet, and we've set an ambition around about 40%, just over 40% by 2030 of vehicles, new vehicles being bought to be electric or hybrid vehicles, and that is consistent with the pathway that that you refer to, convener, in terms of the more than 30% reduction in emissions from transport.
And do you think that is achievable?
Well, we are trying to work with the context that currently we have of the balance between devolved and reserved powers, and clearly some of the powers around transport are reserved. So we are making assumptions around what is achievable at a UK level, and what more we can do to try and increase the uptake of use of electric vehicles themselves through the extensive rollout of electric vehicle charging points, for example, where Scotland is doing some really good work and has a well-developed network of rapid charging points for electric vehicles. So we can do some work on the infrastructure side to help support and indeed change behaviours through car clubs and other means, increase the uptake of use of electric vehicles. But at the same time, we've also got to bear in mind at the moment we don't have all the tools in our box to influence that. So we've tried to be realistic about what we can achieve, and I think it will be challenging. I know Hamza Yousaf and colleagues in the transport team would say that the figures that have been set out are challenging, and indeed they are. are, but we have to be ambitious if we're going to try and achieve the scale of emission reduction that we need across the economy. And bearing in mind, if we don't make progress in transport, some other part of the economy will have to pick up the additional emissions reduction that will be required.
Just on that last point, moving vehicles to electric vehicles, of course, that energy has to be produced somehow. Is that going to be from sources that do not themselves cause carbon emissions?
Well, we have tried in the draft energy strategy, which supports the climate change plan, to develop a strategy which is taking a whole system approach. So we are looking both at supply and use of energy. And clearly, you're right, as we electrify transport and also heat, in respect to some aspects of our heat supply will have to be electrified, where it's not appropriate for other solutions. That will mean that there's going to be a growing demand for electricity, and hence why the strategy is also looking at the supply and needs to further invest in renewable sources of electricity. And indeed in other supporting technologies like pumped hydro storage to ensure that we have the capability to deliver the electricity that our economy will need, whether it's transport or heat or indeed for our wider electricity needs.
Thank you. I'll now move to a question from John Mason.
Thanks, Convener. In the electricity section, we have the policy outcome one, Scotland's electricity grid intensity is below 50 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour. And, I mean, in itself, in that, one of the milestones, for example, is that the UK government delivers a viable route to market for a wide range of renewable technologies. And so the question is, I mean, we've had, some of our witnesses have raised this point about how reliant we are either on the UK or on the EU for actually making some of these things happen. So I would just be interested in your views as to how dependent are we on them and how much is under our own control.
Well, certainly when it comes to electricity generation, it's probably the easiest example to talk about when it comes to that. The key financial instruments which influence the deployment of renewables are very much within the Westminster Parliament's control. So for large-scale deployment of offshore wind, for example, the contract for difference auction process is the way by which funding is allocated to projects. And the Scottish Government doesn't have any direct input into that process, so therefore we are at the mercy of UK ministers in respect of the financial instruments to support the sector. However, one of the key areas that we've had a fundamental sort of change in the environment in recent years has been in respect of onshore wind. And onshore wind currently now has no subsidised route to market for new projects coming on stream. Now, it's worth putting in context, there's over 11 gigawatts of renewable projects which have been going through the consenting process in Scotland, and therefore we have a very strong investor interest in investing in Scotland, but currently no what they would call route to market, in other words, a guaranteed price for the industry to underpin a long-term investment decision. So that is very destabilising. When it comes to pumped hydro storage, there's no route to market at all either. So we have existing stations which have agreements with National Grid and regulated by Ofgem around providing energy from pumped hydro storage facilities and foyers and in Cruachan, for example, which help balance the grid, and they are being heavily used in terms of ensuring that the quality of the electricity that comes through the network to consumers is of a good quality and reliability and doesn't have fluctuations. And you may sometimes see in lighting in particular, where it's more obvious where you get fluctuations and lights flickering. So to avoid that and ensure there's a quality supply and indeed to ensure that there is sufficient black start capability if ever there was a power outage, pumped hydro storage is important. We have massive investment projects lined up for Scotland in Coire Glas, above Loch Ness, and indeed in Dumfries and Galloway at Glenmuckluck, which will go ahead if there is a route to market. So these are hundreds of millions of pounds each projects, but we do need a route to market similar. What we've encouraged the UK government to think about is a similar mechanism to that for interconnectors. So there's a cap and floor mechanism, so the developer has some certainty about the price being within a range, maybe not a guaranteed price, but they have an upper and lower level, and they know that their investment is relatively secure. So that's what the industry is looking for, and again, we need UK ministers to be expansive on that front. When it comes to offshore wind, we have made the point that we recognise the UK government has, in their view, an electoral mandate to not subsidise new wind energy projects. We believe there's strong support for projects in Scotland, you know, from local communities who want them to happen. And the solution, we think, to cross that problem is to encourage the UK government to allow a zero subsidy CFD auction process to take place. So no public subsidy whatsoever, but to give a guaranteed supply of electricity at a guaranteed price to allow the development to have sufficient certainty to take place. Where we do have some influence is how we can support particularly community-led schemes. We are doing work through our REEF, the Renewable Energy Infrastructure Fund, and CARES, which is a fund which we use to help support communities develop the feasibility of projects. So we do try and help community projects and do try and provide support through the planning system to new renewable energy sources to be deployed, but unfortunately the financial instruments are under the control of the UK Parliament. Yes.
So from what you're saying, the community side, which we would have a lot more influence over, but there's other areas where really, and I'm not certainly not arguing with your arguments, but you're going to put these arguments to the UK government, but they may or may not obviously accept them. Mm-hmm. I mean, if they don't accept them or don't accept all of them, does that put some of our targets and aims at risk?
Well, there is no doubt that, and I'll be explicit about it, that it's becoming more challenging to meet our target for 2020, the 100% target. We are still pursuing that and pushing for that. We've invited to the draft energy strategy, which sits alongside the climate change plan, the industry to feedback into us their thoughts about how best we can deliver perhaps which would be a UK first, a zero subsidy onshore wind industry. So we are inviting people to come forward with ideas how we can deliver projects. And that means government working with industry to see if we can identify areas in which we can eliminate cost to try and there are obviously some exceptional costs that affect sites around the UK, MOD, NATS, again, these are areas, the National Air Traffic Control System, where they have an impact on cost, but where we can directly influence through trying to be supportive around the planning system and to encourage the industry to look potentially at areas such as repowering existing sites as well and extension of life to sites. Where an extension to life might help is that it improves the economics of the asset, can be the cost of the asset can be recovered over a longer period of time, then the requirement for subsidy is reduced. So we are trying to work with the industry to say, look, if the UK government does not come forward with a more supportive environment, what else can we do? Mm-hmm. We've invited comment around the potential role and remit of a government-owned energy company and indeed the role and remit around renewable energy bonds as well, to see if there's other ways in which we can finance projects. But we're always open to constructive input from the industry as to how Scottish Government can influence this, but we are continuing to try and push the UK Government to come forward with more positive policies which accept that there is a stronger case perhaps in Scotland for supporting renewable projects. We do have a fortunate position that sites in Scotland, by virtue of the fact of having a higher average wind speed than many other parts of the UK mainland, and particularly in our island with the remote island wind issue, which is at present, we know we have got efficient sites which are very competitive. If there was a CFD auction, which was a zero subsidy one, we're very confident Scottish projects would do well in that because they are economically very strong projects from an efficiency point of view. The other area which, with your patience, Convener, I could just mention, where we do need a more supportive environment is around transmission charging. Because that clearly has a big impact, not just on, as we've seen with the premature closure of Longannet, but also with the renewable industry, it has a profound impact on the ability to compete in an auction process if there's an unfair charging regime for projects in Scotland which are paying a higher price, perhaps reflecting an older model of electricity generation, which was about big thermal plants providing power, exporting it to England and other parts of GB.
Okay, just a final question, if I may, Convener. I mean, you've listed quite a number of things there where we kind of need the UK government to, you know, change policy or whatever. I mean, is it just the question that we're hoping to get all of these, or are there some areas that you feel is more of an open door and some of these that you've listed are more of a closed door?
Well, I did. I mean, I could have gone on to other areas like tidal as well, but I'm conscious that I'm eating into your time. But there is indeed a long area, a long list of areas where we've asked for a more supportive position from UK ministers. And it was very helpful indeed to have the debate in the chamber recently to get strong support for Scotland's renewable industry from around the parties in the Scottish Parliament to put a message forward that we need UK ministers to listen and to try and be more supportive of the industry where they can be. So we're not expecting a free lunch. We know that consumers ultimately pay for the electricity they buy. But when you see in the context of a very strong commitment being given to Hinkley, a new nuclear power station with a long-term commitment at a price which is higher than onshore wind is already providing to the grid, so already at least a £10 differential between the power that is being purchased in 2025 from Hinkley C power station compared with onshore wind, which in the most recent CFD auction which it competed in was coming in at £82.50. So onshore wind is already cost competitive. What we're trying to see is a common sense argument to UK ministers. Support these industries, support their development where they are supported by many communities in parts of UK, not just Scotland. Allow that to happen and you'll actually be diversifying the risk of higher prices where you've got a nuclear commitment, a stronger electricity strike price, and mix that with technologies like onshore wind, solar and other technologies, and I'm confident offshore wind will also come down significantly in price, and ultimately tidal and wave in slightly further down the line. So we are trying to encourage the UK government to look at that, to make sure that they are taking full account of the trajectory in which these technologies are, that they are on their cost reduction trajectories, and if they back those industries and get economies of scale, we'll see significant reductions in cost. We're seeing it with offshore wind right now. Some sites in Netherlands and other places coming out well below the target prices that the UK government has set through its CFD auction process. So it is happening. They just need to back those industries and then reap the supply chain benefits that come from that as well. Okay. We've commissioned nuclear power, nothing against using technology from abroad, but where we have got the ability to support domestic industries, whether it's tidal energy or offshore wind, why aren't we? It's a gilt-edged opportunity to generate jobs in fabrication as well as generate the electricity from a sustainable source.
Okay, thanks so much.
Come to Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Convener. I was actually curious about energy efficiency measures, which we're coming to now. The goal for residential energy efficiency, I think, is 6% reduction in heat demand. It's smaller and slower than getting all homes to an EPC C rating by 2025, which was what the Fuel Poverty Forum certainly recommended. Are you not accepting their recommendation?
Well, we are very supportive of improving the energy efficiency of our stock, so let me make no bones about that. But what we're trying to do is deliver a pathway which is cost-effective and deliverable. We have had challenges in recent years in trying to move, especially when it comes to new build stock, to try and convince house builders during a very tough economic climate, to make that leap of faith and start moving towards higher and higher energy efficiency standards for new builds. And I think we can work with industry to achieve that. But we have, as I'm sure that we have a very big challenge with existing building stock. We are moving through, we've done very well in terms of rollout of the energy efficiency measures in terms of cavity wall insulation and more traditional sort of insulation products into now more difficult to treat properties, rural properties, solid wall construction, and in combination with the need to address that, if we were to go purely for making the building stock itself energy efficient to a standard, that might eliminate options which might be more attractive, more cost effective for particular buildings. So I've seen myself in places like Inverclyde the impact that projects can have in terms of district heating and reducing the cost of energy to residents, tenants in a large high-rise block. We need to have a sophisticated enough approach that can take account of the context in which we're trying to achieve the energy efficiency measures. And so I'm not resistant per se to what is being pushed for in terms of improvements, but we have set out in the energy strategy that we have been making steady progress in terms of the average energy efficiency rating of our building stock over time. But we need to try and take a more balanced approach.
It sounds as if you're not going to go for that recommendation, although you're not resisting it. It's slightly different to being wholeheartedly in favour.
Well, I wouldn't want to shut anything down. I mean, we certainly, this is a draft energy strategy, and we are listening genuinely. So if the committee and indeed the industry feel it is achievable and they're able to convince us that, then certainly we'll be looking to listen to that.
I suppose then if you've gone for this 6% energy efficiency target, do you think that is sufficient to end the poor energy performance of homes?
Well, in of itself, no. Obviously, we need to invest in rollout of energy efficiency measures. Targets in themselves are just a means of measuring progress. We obviously need to back it with investment, and that's why, you know, the SEPA's a national infrastructure project, and in the budget, if it passes this week, there's over £500 million committed in the period up to 2020 to roll out provisions in the SEPA process. Obviously, are looking beyond that, so it's a multi-billion pound programme over a period over more than one decade to achieve the kind of quality of building stock that we think the people of Scotland deserve over a period of time, and we want to work with not just domestic properties but also non-domestic properties too, and that can be very challenging. And indeed, in encounters I've had in our new towns because of the in East Kilbride and other locations, we know that buildings have been built at roughly the same time. You've got a huge number of non-domestic properties which are in need of investment in energy efficiency. That's both a problem for those local authority areas, but also an opportunity in that you might learn something through being able to roll out a programme with relative efficiency over a larger number of building units because they are all of the same type. You can learn a lot from doing the first one to make an efficiency and economies of scale of doing subsequent ones. So we are obviously got a consultation which is live around SEEP. We're looking for input from industry and indeed stakeholders such as Poverty Alliance and others to see how we can achieve our goals. But if I maybe bring Cathy Robertson and just if there's anything she'd like to say on the technical parameters around the target and the deliverability of the energy rating.
So on EPCC, I think the at the moment we've achieved, I think, two-thirds of our residential properties are already at that level. And as the Minister mentions, the next tranche of that are the much harder to treat and often the rural remote areas. And I think alongside the energy demand reduction, there's also a big challenge in terms of ensuring that particularly vulnerable people have the best energy prices and are paying a fair price for their energy. So looking at smart technology, smart meter rollout, trying to make the best of that, looking at switching, and we're not very good at switching in Scotland, so trying to encourage more switching to get the best energy prices alongside improving the demand reduction on the properties.
The real test will be whether we actually improve, you know, the energy performance of these homes, because you can do all these measures and people still remain in fuel poverty. One final small question, Convener. We know that a lot of the problem, as well as being in rural areas, is in private sector stock, particularly private sector rented stock. Are you intending regulations, because it was a bit vague as to both private sector tenants and private sector owners, for that matter. And so I wonder whether you could expand on your plans there.
We'll certainly recognise the problem. You know, like many members around the table, I sort of represent a rural area, and I know that it can be very challenging. Where it may be easy, or not easy as such, but easier in some urban contexts, working with large-scale landlords, such as registered social landlords and councils, to roll out a large, wide-scale programme. We also have the issue of owner-occupiers in amongst that estate, and also private rented properties, too, in that context. So it is more complicated than I'm presenting, but in a rural context, there's very much more dominance of private rented accommodation, as you quite rightly say. What we have to do is look at a mixture of where possible, perhaps regulation as a way of driving that. We obviously have to be proportionate about it and bear in mind affordability. But we do have the benefit of taking a strategic approach in the long term, is that we can take a very long telescope, if you like, to look at where we're trying to get to, and bring people this over a longer transitional period, so that it's not a kind of overnight thing where people are having to do it, you know, straight away. People will on an annual basis more longer term intervals will be upgrading their properties, investing in properties, and if they know that they have by a certain period of time to get to an energy efficiency standard, then that gives them a long deadline, if you like, that they can achieve, and hopefully they'll be able to develop an approach there which gets them to the destination point in a cost-effective way. So there's a mixture of regulation, yes, we will consider that, and that's something that we're looking at doing, and also working with local authorities to look at local heat and energy efficiency strategies being developed, and there's a separate consultation on that issue to invite COSLA and other local authorities, and indeed wider stakeholders, to give us their thoughts on the impact that may have in terms of helping support development of district heating, making sure that we connect up large industrial sources of heat, perhaps to provide local district heating opportunities, which clearly we would also be encouraging, where possible, owner-occupiers and private sector landlords to get involved in that, to be part of that. It certainly makes sense if there's a mixed tenure block for everybody to be involved and benefit from any efficiencies in procurement at that point, rather than having to do something separately, which might be a bespoke solution, much more costly for them. So we'll try and work with energy suppliers as well to try and encourage them to be involved in it. And we've also got in parallel with that the rollout of smart meters as well, which is certainly, I think, will accelerate once we have SMETS 2 meters, which are the sort of more technically advanced meters, which can allow, I think, are more attractive to the industry as well and consumers for switching. So there's lots of things happening. But I think you're right that we may need to try and provide a mixture of a carrot and stick, but be mindful of affordability and giving people as much long-term notice as possible to achieve that. I don't know whether Cathy wants to add anything to that.
On the private rented sector, domestic sector, there is a plan to consult on that hopefully next month, and within that, then an idea of timescales to consult on in our occupier sector as well.
Okay, thank you.
Gillian Martin.
When we're looking at the climate change plan, there was quite a lot of reliance on carbon capture and storage, bioenergy, carbon capture and storage as a core technology for delivering decarbonisation. I mean, given, and you'll know that in my area, Peterhead, we're kind of leading the way in developing that technology, and the funding was pulled by the UK government. If we're unable to rely on that, I mean, what implications would that have?
Well, it is very significant. I'd say two things about this. One, that Peterhead is extremely important for the energy supply in Scotland more generally. So we are steadily, as I'm sure you're aware, moving towards a decarbonised electricity system in Scotland. But Peterhead does provide a very important function at this moment in time, in terms of both in terms of providing baseload power, which is important, of course, in its own right, but also its black start capability for resilience of the energy system. So it is a very important bit of infrastructure. Clearly, we're trying to find a future for Peterhead which would be sustainable in a genuine way, with a low carbon vision for our energy system. And we believe CCS, while it's not universally supported, I appreciate it, is a very important technology potentially to allow Peterhead to continue to provide power for the grid, but in a way which does sequester the carbon emissions which come from the plant. And that in itself might provide a valuable industry which will help use hopefully not prematurely decommissioned, but decommissioned oil and gas infrastructure to be able to store carbon dioxide. Proposed that in the central North Sea there are reservoirs that have been largely depleted of oil, which could be suitable for storing carbon dioxide. But we know from, and it's set out in the climate change plan, that under section 7.2 that we state that the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, and the International Energy Agency and the Committee on Climate Change have all identified carbon capture and storage as an essential low-cost climate mitigation technology. Essentially, the IPCC and other parties are saying that it would cost 138% more to achieve a 2-degree scenario without carbon capture and storage. So we think there's a common sense point of view there. We've got the opportunity, in even if I suspend my own political beliefs for a second, at a UK level there is an asset there that can be used. The infrastructure is there to be used. There's a power station that could provide the power, but also do it in trialling CCS technology. And I certainly share local people's disappointment in Peterhead, indeed your own disappointment, that the plug was well and truly pulled from out of the plug hole by the UK government in that respect. And of course that came after Longannet, having had originally had its hopes raised that it was going to be a site for CCS. So it's the constant chopping and changing in terms of UK policy position which is destabilising. I don't think it's appropriate for us just to sit and expect the world to develop a technology that we can then exploit in this situation when we've got a gilt-edged opportunity at Peterhead to do it. And I think if we don't do it, there's a risk that some of the offshore infrastructure, as mature fields are decommissioned, will be lost to us. So it's there's a timing issue here as well, that I think there's an imperative to get the technology up and running and to contribute in the way that IPCC and International Energy Agency believe it shall in helping the world keep to a 2-degree scenario or less. And it will also reduce the cost of the economy of achieving that trajectory. So I think for all sorts of reasons, it's extremely short-sighted what has happened in terms of UK policy position on this. As we've seen previously with wind energy, where research funding was pulled from under that, and we've seen Germany and Denmark exploit the technology, and good on them for doing it, because we've definitely needed the technology, but that should have been a UK-based industry. And similarly with CCS, you've got an opportunity to develop technology that can help the world deal with this issue and reap the economic opportunity that comes from that too. So I just hope they see sense.
So given that that research funding was pulled and obviously we're facing a Brexit situation, does that have an impact in terms of the university research that could be ongoing to make up for the fact that UK funding was pulled from
Well, ultimately what we need is demonstration projects. And there are different scales of project that could be undertaken, and I might in a second maybe bring in Chris on this, Chris Stark, with the convener's permission, but because I know we've looked at what is being done elsewhere. But we do have to demonstrate the technology and to be able to, like other industries, like in the renewable technologies referred to earlier, demonstrate how the cost can be brought down as well. So it's about making it cost effective. It won't be cheap to start with, and I accept that it's not, but it's a worthwhile commitment, and it will ultimately help both the UK and indeed Europe and wider world community achieve climate emissions that we need to make. Clearly, we are very much supportive of renewable energy, and I want to stress that. We are pushing renewables in a big way, clearly, within Scotland, and encouraging the UK government to do more than they are on that. But I do think the UK as a whole needs this, and I think, indeed, Europe and the wider world needs CCS to be deployable. Where there are many countries around the world that will not have the renewable energy opportunities that UK and Scotland have. And what is their solution? What is going to be their solution to lowering their climate emissions if they're reliant on either fossil fuel-based fuels for energy generation? We need to help, and we've got a vital role to play in that, and we can also generate export earnings from the knowledge and expertise and technology we build up. But you're right that access to European funding is very important across all areas of energy research and development. We have performed very well in attracting funding from Horizon 2020 and other European funding sources. Our universities are foremost amongst the academic community in Europe in leading on areas like marine energy, but also in areas like CCS, where academics at Edinburgh University and other institutions are very proactive.
Okay, thank you.
If I can maybe bring Chris Stark and convener just to add to that.
Not much to add to that, but just to say that, I do think it's credible that carbon capture and storage can play a part in the future. So we were all stung by the decision to pull the funding for the competition, which we were very hopeful Peterhead would benefit from. And you see in the energy strategy in particular a reflection of that. So we're looking at small-scale demonstration, at least in the interim, but with a clear view that that should grow to something in the 2020s and 2030s that actually plays a meaningful part of the energy system. It's essential, though, I think, that we work with UK government on that. There is real stuff going on at the moment, so we have put real funding into real projects in Scotland for CCS. And we'll be contributing to the consultation that UK government is running at the moment on its industrial strategy to make the point that carbon capture and storage should be a meaningful part of that in the future.
Chris, you're obviously involved in the Times modelling that if CCS were taken out of the equation, what would that effectively mean?
So we can manage without CCS. It's just that it will cost us more. So there is a. If you think of the modelling as a, you know, the primary issue for the model is to achieve the targets at the lowest, what we call system cost. That is, you might think of that as the lowest cost to the whole economy in Scotland. It's perfectly possible to do that without CCS. It's just that, you know, with CCS that we have the ability to do it at a cheaper system cost overall. So it makes sense. The modelling which underpins that is the same modelling that my colleagues in UK government will be using when they think about the future too. So we would expect the same arguments to apply.
Okay, thank you.
Minister, before we move on, Schleswig-Holstein, where most of or much of the German renewable wind energy is from, of course, although not always part of Germany, is not looking for independence from Germany. Do you agree that a stable political system is also helpful in this area?
I think a supportive political system is very helpful, I think, too. I would put it, convener. I bow to your superior knowledge about the location in Germany of the technology, but you know, I believe that what we have to have, and I've believed this since before I took this post, actually, because I met a number of key industry players when I was out at my first climate change conference in Doha, where they were all saying what had been really attractive about Scotland at that point, this is back in 2012, was around having a long-term commitment and stable policy position on the issue. So they had certainty about the government's commitment to the growth of renewables, the well-known 100% target for 2020, and a very supportive, you know, environment around it. So whether Schleswig-Holstein becomes independent or not, I'm not sure, but I'm sure as long as the supportive policies are in place and the right fiscal and regulatory regime is in place, then we'll continue to see investment. And I think international players recognise that Scotland is amongst the most progressive administrations anywhere in the world in terms of support for renewable energy. And I think that's the thing that they're most attracted to.
Right. I think my point was Schleswig-Holstein is not looking to be independent. But we'll move on, Minister, to a question from Bill Bowman.
Thank you, Convener. Back to Scotland. Minister, you touched on briefly thermal generation of electricity, and I think the Scottish Government has expressed a desire to see new thermal capacity to provide, to quote, baseload capacity and support the resilience of the electricity system. Now, we've heard evidence that would suggest that the investment is unlikely to come in the near future due to transmission and infrastructure costs. We've also heard from the National Grid that they would say that they could meet the peak demand on the from the UK grid, as they would call it, through the interconnections that are either in place or shortly to be in place. So given that, why is new thermal capacity considered to be strategically important? And under what scenario would you consider Scotland would actually need this new thermal capacity?
Well, I think the first thing to say is we've got thermal capacity at Peterhead, and we'd like to see that. Obviously, there's been a capacity auction that has been unsuccessful from the point of view of the operators, and they've been unable to secure a contract at this point. So our first priority is to make sure there's a long-term sustainable future for Peterhead. But as Mr. Bowman knows, there are a number of sites in Scotland which are either a case of Longannet or Cockenzie, which have been vacated. In the case of Cockenzie, there is a planning consent for a new thermal plant. But quite right that the transmission charges have been cited as a key reason why new thermal capacity will not come forward at this moment in time. But for the reasons I gave earlier on, whether you talk about pumped hydro storage or thermal capacity, we are going to see a growth in requirement for electricity in the Scottish economy as we decarbonise vehicle fleet and decarbonise our heat system. We need to provide reliable, secure sources of electricity. Thermal has a role in that mix. We've never been of the view that we should have a one technology energy supply, so we've always been pushing a range of technologies. And as I've said earlier, Peterhead provides a particularly important role at this moment in time from a black start capability point of view as well. We need a range of thermal plant around the GB system to be able to help kickstart the system and get the grid back up running in the hopefully unlikely event that a black start would ever happen. But it is an important part of the mix, and losing Longannet has been significant in that respect. But we are supportive of new thermal capacity being established in Scotland, we have put in place measures which would require that to be CCS, capable of deploying CCS to ensure it doesn't become a net addition to climate emissions. And indeed, the point that Chris Stark was discussing with Gillian Martin regarding the impact of CCS and indeed bioenergy is that it helps us get into negative emissions for our electricity sector. So clearly, we've got that's where we have to be in order to deliver on the pathway in the climate change plan, is to have negative emissions in our electricity generation sector, according to this current mix that we have here. So it's important any thermal capacity is capable of being adapted to that technology to reduce the potential risk that it adds to emissions. But we we do face the barrier that transmission charges are unhelpful at this moment in time. I know that National Grid and Ofgem are looking at the transmission charging regime, reflecting the fact that we have moved to a different, more distributed electricity generation model now, and the current charging regime is perhaps reflecting the old system where there was a large number of large plants which were largely providing exported electricity to the rest of the GB grid.
I can come back on that. The National Grid were making the point, I think, that it would be unlikely that every asset or every generational asset in Scotland would go down at the same time. There would be some residual power there. Plus, they were saying that they had enough through the interconnectors to get it started again. Is that a differing technical view that you have?
No. I mean, I wasn't disagreeing with National Grid. We do, on a day-to-day basis, There's enough power in the grid, and obviously we've got interconnection to Europe as well, which from time to time is topping up the energy supply in the UK. We would argue that there, in terms of likes of offshore wind, for example, where we're seeing a lot of development off the coast of England, that there is a concentration of, they're good sites, they're cost competitive sites. I'm not objecting to that in principle. It's a good thing. But you've got all your eggs in one basket. We need to have a more diverse range of sites. We need offshore wind sites in Scotland, and indeed we are pushing floating offshore wind for the same reason that we need to have ability to have wherever, usually, sadly, although it's a strength in this respect, wherever you are in British Isles, there will be a wind somewhere. Mm-hmm. And so we need to be able to benefit from that when it's happening. The thermal capacity, if there was a problem, as we've seen, with the nuclear plants in France, when they lost a large number of them simultaneously for a common safety issue, and it was precautionary in most cases, but it did hit their supply, and they had a shortfall in supply. We've got severe weather events that can happen, which can take out interconnectors and can take out grid infrastructure, so you may have issues there. So it's quite a complex picture, but I do agree with National Grid. On a day-to-day basis at the moment, we do have enough power in the grid, but we need to be able to future-proof as we grow our electricity demand in time. We need to be able to provide appropriate backup to that.
I think they were saying it's not just a day-to-day basis, that on the, is it a black start you called it, there would be enough. I mean, is it just technically you disagree with them, or do you would just like to have a thermal plant here?
Well, we are doing quite a lot of work with National Grid and indeed Scottish Power and Scottish Hydro Energy Transmissions to look at issues around grid resilience. There is a report which has been commissioned, which is hopefully due to be published in the near future, which will lay out the position in terms of the security supply at a GB level and Scotland's place within that. So I don't want to prejudge that, but I do believe we need to invest in firstly maintaining Peterhead and making sure that Peterhead is not lost to the GB grid. And we do need to consider what options we can take forward to encourage CCS-enabled thermal capacity to be established. And for that, we do need the UK government to obviously to continue to pursue a CCS agenda. But I think it's important we consider what we need for the long term. And while the situation may be okay now, but we're going to be seeing electrification of transport and heat, we're going to need more electricity, not less. This becomes an important issue.
Sorry, just one last. Did you say you were going to invest in Peterhead?
We are. Well, it's as you know, it's a reserved area, but we're looking to work with SSE to see if there's ways in which we can help. Clearly, we want to secure a long-term future for that plant, and to work with the company and indeed National Grid to make sure that happens in Ofgem. So there is a desire to work together on it, and we'll work with UK ministers in that respect as well. It's a genuine partnership, and I hope UK ministers see whether it's Scotland or other parts of the UK that they need to ensure that there's a resilient electricity supply network there for the future, and not relying overlay in one technology, whether it's Hinkley or offshore wind in one part of the country. We need to have capability to have a resilient electricity grid for the long haul, and we'll work with the industry and our counterparts in UK government to achieve that.
Gil Patterson.
It's on transmission charges, and I heard what you said, that you're aware that the charging mechanism at the present time is detrimental to Scotland. And you know, in a wider context, that obviously the UK, I think, is looking at thermal installations for strategic reasons, because if you look at what's coming on board from abroad, then the same question could be raised that we wouldn't need any thermal. So I think it's for strategic reasons. So in that regard, would the Scottish Government, the fact that presently that you're paid at the present time to connect if you're London or thereabouts, whereas there's a charge when it's further away from London. So if this wooing that you're engaged in to have a fairer system in the national grid, if that fails, and since we should be looking on the basis of a strategic supply, because we are not, as I understand it, in a UK basis, able to maintain the levels with any surety. So therefore, should that be the case, would the Scottish Government perhaps, rather than invest, consider maybe, since there is chat about the Scottish Government being involved in the energy business himself, would the Scottish Government consider maybe perhaps taking over Peterhead for strategic reasons?
We're not there yet. I think it's important to I do understand the point that's been made, and the importance of Peterhead can't be overstated, I think, in terms of Scotland's needs. Certainly for the near future, we need a plant like Peterhead to be providing power for the network and to provide that black start capability. I mean, it's pumped hydro and other areas are very important to kick-starting those thermal plants to get them up and running, but it's the thermal plants that really carry the weight of getting the grid back up and running once it's fired up. So it's very important to us. The transmission charging regime, you're quite right, there are parts of England where actually new projects are paid to connect to the grid, such as the peculiarities of the transmission charging regime, whereas we see substantial costs for plants, and I'm sure members will be aware that Longannet faced an annual bill of about £40 million to connect to the grid, which played a big part in its premature closure. And clearly, while the longer term we are trying to decarbonise our energy mix, as is set out in the Energy Strategy and Climate Change Plan, that was an unhelpful development in of its own right, and it happened so precipitately because of the financial pressures that are caused by the transmission charging regime. And these are points that have been very strongly made by the Scottish Government to UK ministers in the past. We will certainly consider what we can do to support Peterhead, and I don't want to prejudge how we go, but clearly we have a very strong strategic interest in making sure that Peterhead is up and running. there is a real risk, I think, that the regulatory regime, the transmission charging mechanisms, are purely sort of cost driven rather than thinking about the socio-economic aspects of what is being provided by the electricity infrastructure, the grid. And clearly we would argue that it would make absolute sense where you've got Scotland something like 32% of UK's landmass, projects that are in that 32% of UK's landmass are to some extent being faced with an unacceptably high barrier to connect to the grid. And it has, when you've got financial mechanisms, if I go beyond thermal into areas like offshore wind, and indeed if there is ever a zero subsidy CFD auction process for onshore wind, these technologies are having to start from a position where they've got a higher cost than their competitors in the auction process before they even start to put anything in the ground. They've got the transmission charges are unhelpful in allowing them to compete on a level playing field with sites elsewhere. Fortunately, as I said earlier on, wind sites are particularly good in terms of their efficiency, their capacity factors, the load factors in Scotland are higher than in many other parts of the country, which to some extent counteracts those higher charges. But for thermal, you don't have that advantage. So it's if you're burning coal, oil or gas, then it's the same coal, oil or gas that you're burning somewhere else. You don't have a cost efficiency advantage in that respect to overcome transmission charges that are unhelpfully high in Scotland. But we will do whatever we can within our powers to help maintain the resilience of the electricity system in Scotland. I can assure you of that.
I think you dodged a bullet there a wee bit in my real question. And I'll ask it again. But, well, I mean, from my point of view, there is no UK grid. You know, it's clearly not with these mechanisms in place. But I wonder if there's any legal impediment on you as a government to invest in energy. Is there anything that stops you that would hold you back?
I'll defer to colleagues in a second on the legal aspect of that, if I may, Mr. Patterson. But certainly, I didn't mean to dodge the point previously that I think you're referring to. So I'll just answer that while I've got the chance. Certainly, at the moment, I believe there's between a 5% to 6% capacity margin in the GB energy grid, so electricity grid. So in other words, we on balance, we produce about 5 or 6% more than we need. And so National Grid are right at peak. You can usually cope with. There's not been a problem to date. In Scotland, of course, we in the last year for which we got figures, we exported 29% of the electricity we generated. So we are playing a particularly important role in maintaining that capacity, that safety margin, if you like, at GB level. So Scotland plays a particularly important role. So if we are losing plants like Longannet, which has come out since those figures were produced, that is chipping away at that safety margin at a GB level, not just in Scotland, but impacts on it. We obviously need to address that concern, and we have raised that concern with UK ministers and National Grid. But we clearly want to support maintenance of such facilities in Scotland, and indeed to in terms of legal aspects of whether we could intervene to shore up a particular plant like Peterhead. I will now carefully pass the hospital pass to Chris Stark, who may be aware of the legal aspects there.
I mean, there are some barriers to any form of state ownership in any market, and most of them are presented in the state aid framework. The other barrier or a hurdle, I think is probably a better way of considering it, is the regulatory barriers. So in the scenario that you've presented there, we would have to have a licence to generate and be part of that market. And it's worth noting that Ofgem have made an offer to us for us to consider some of those things. There's a commitment in the energy strategy for to consult on what we've called a government-owned energy company, which could take many forms. And it's good to have on record, I think, actually, that there's a good record of partnership working with the regulator, and we'll explore that with them. So they've offered what they've called a regulatory sandbox, which is a good term, I think, to consider some of the regulatory aspects. But the short answer to your question is it is possible.
We'll move on from the sandbox to questions from Andy Whiteman.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just three questions on residential and heat. Residential is targeted to have a 76% reduction in emissions by 2032. But areas like transport and agriculture are taking much less strain, and yet by 2032 we'll have 33% and 26% of emissions. And given that transport and agriculture in particular have been predicated on inputs to the Times model and constraints have been placed upon expectations of, for example, demand reduction in transport, to what extent are we placing unreasonable expectations on the residential sector to reduce carbon emissions?
I recognise the issue. What I would say has been, I think in Times, I'll maybe ask Chris Stark and maybe Mike to comment on the Times model in this respect, but I don't think agriculture is picked up by Times. It's the analysis that had to be done separately from the Times model, because it's Times is primarily focused on the energy aspects. So it is difficult to model in that respect. Obviously, agriculture itself, I know, and Fergus Ewing, if he was here, would tell you it's been on a steady downward trajectory in emissions. And so what we're effectively seeing is we need to see that continue in the period of the climate change plan. On the residential side, I would hope that we can present a scenario where we are delivering climate change emission reductions in the residential sector, and also doing it in a way which actually helps save people money, make people less exposed to fuel poverty, and through the points that Jackie Bailey's making earlier on around SEEP and tackling the energy efficiency of our housing stock, and indeed helping our business community if going beyond the residential sector into non-domestic, helping businesses and individuals, residents, to improve the energy efficiency of their housing stock, become more fuel efficient, obviously, and therefore save them money. And obviously improve their health and other benefits that come from having a warm, dry, well-heated home. So that is a very important aspect. So we'll be trying to find ways in which we can encourage people to be part of this. We've had some successes in recent years in terms of the work that's been done around behavioural, low-carbon behaviour framework by the Greener Together team and the Scottish Government, looking at how we could incentivise and encourage people through good practice, if you like, to do the right thing. And clearly we're going to have to, in residential sector is purely dealing with, I suppose, the properties. We've also got the transport side of it. We're going to have to encourage individuals to change their vehicles to lower emission vehicles and try and find a way of encouraging that where we don't have the direct fiscal tools at our disposal, but we can provide incentives and provide the infrastructure to support that the network of infrastructure or charging points to support the rollout of electric vehicles. So we're going to have to be quite positive in how we try and help encourage individuals, householders, to lower their emissions. But we recognise it's a pretty hefty challenge, but we always knew it would get more difficult as time went by. And the importance of achieving the target can't be understated, because if we don't, the impact on our environment and indeed the global community could be devastating. So it's a mixture of trying to encourage people to do the right thing, but we need to try and provide a cost-effective way to do it and helping private householders. And the consultation that Cathy referred to will try and unpick this, in terms of private rented householders, how we incentivise them to get part of the rollout of energy efficiency programmes and make it easy for them to be part of it, if we can do so.
Okay, thank you. I'm conscious of time, so I'll move on to my second question on heat. Policy outcome one under residential, you say the Scottish Government wants improvements to the fabric of Scotland's domestic buildings results in a 6% reduction in their heat demand by 2032. My understanding is that 6% reduction is a 6% reduction on the forecast demand in 2032 as opposed to a 6% reduction on any baseline demand figure. Now, can you clarify what that means?
If I may, I may be bringing Cathy here, because I know Cathy will study the figures more carefully.
I might pass that to Mark, actually.
Apologies.
I think that's based on where we are now, moving forward to 2032, isn't
it? Yeah, 6% reduction from the starting period to the period in 2032. But it takes account of the demand drivers as well, that are driving demand in the residential sector going forward as well.
So with respect, if demand today is an index of 100, in 2032 demand will be 94.
So fabric measures will reduce overall demand by 6% on 2032 levels.
So what is that forecast 2032 demand?
I don't have those figures with me, but we can certainly write to you about that.
That would be extremely helpful, thank you, if you could do that. And then moving finally on to, the residential carbon emissions reduction relies heavily towards the end of the this period on technological solutions. In our PP2, the last plan on low carbon heat technology, it said, and I quote, "We intend to produce a detailed proposal on how we realise this potential in our PP3. This is our PP3 in effect. Tables 8.7 in your climate change plan here says we will look to put forward a more detailed proposal on how we will realise this potential in subsequent climate change plans." I mean, are you ever going to do it, given that your commitment was to do it in this plan?
Well, I mean, we are, I stress, I mean, I recognise the point, because obviously I was involved with RPP2 last time around. I know we faced a challenge at that point in time that technology, you know, wasn't there, but we knew that research was being done. We do have a lot of work being done through LCITP and SEEP programmes to pilot technologies, and there's some really good work going on. I visited a project just covering Edinburgh, East Lothian, Mid Lothian, involving SunAmp, which is a business based in East Lothian, which is providing heat battery storage. So there are really big steps forward being taken. There's obviously a lot of properties these days where combi boilers don't have storage capacity for hot water, and so, you know, being able to store heat in another way is a space efficient way of doing it. So there are companies like that which we are supporting to try and take forward new technology. So I think there's significant funding going into research and development in this area to reassure Mr. Whiteman, and I would hope that you know, we can develop technological solutions, but we'll reflect on the point he's made, and if there's with Ms. Cunningham, we can come back with any further detail, then that will be helpful. But maybe, I don't know, if with the convener's consent, bring in Cathy just to see if there's anything further we can say on that just now.
Associated with the climate change plan and the energy strategy, we're also consulting on SEEP, and in particular heat. So specifically looking at two aspects of heat, which are not particularly against one technology against another, but looking at regulation for district heating and also local heat and energy efficiency strategies, considering that local authorities might in their own areas understand the demand and supply and to be able to zone particular areas for particular heat technologies. I think in the context of the climate change plan, the focus is between now and the mid-20s on, as I mentioned earlier, on demand reduction and no or low regrets heat solutions. So in off-gas grid areas, maybe individual solutions like heat pumps for individual buildings, or in high dense heat density areas, district heating where that makes commercial sense regardless. But until that point, I think we're not going to be sure what's going to happen in particular to the gas grid and whether there's going to be any options around that in repurposing or greening the gas grid. And we want to be very sure that we understand what's coming, what will be happening across the UK before we push people or businesses into taking up one particular technology and then they have a stranded asset or become regretful for making that choice. But I think it's fair to say that in our heat statement, which we published last year, we are very clear that all technologies are going to be required. So we will actually need everything in relation to heat to make our targets. But it's that specific focus that you're looking for. I guess as far as we can go, it's 2025 on district heating, heat pumps, and one or two of the other tested technologies at this point in time.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there, convener.
Right, thank you. We have a short supplementary from Gordon MacDonald before we move to Ash Denham for further questions. Perhaps if, in light of time, to try and perhaps keep answers a bit more focused. And, of course, there will be an opportunity to write in about any issues that there hasn't been an opportunity to perhaps cover as fully as the Minister or those with him might have liked to, and I think the committee may write to just clarify one or two areas as well. So I'll come to a short supplementary from Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just wanted to ask about how realistic the transport target of reduction of 31% between 2017 and 2032 is, bearing in mind that the latest figures from the Department of Transport says that the ultra-low emission vehicles that were purchased in 2016 was only 1.2% of the total. And given that much of the responsibility for regulation in this area either lies with the UK government or with the EU, so I was just wondering how realistic you thought that target was.
Well, I mean, it's going to be challenging, and I think I acknowledged that earlier on. Mr. MacDonald is quite right to identify that there's, you know, we have different governments involved, and different, indeed, EU as well have a distinct role in terms of oversight over emission standards. What we're seeing around Europe is quite a significant move now by different, even cities within countries like Paris has set a target to ban fossil fuel cars from its environment, I think by the mid-2020s, but we can check that and come back to committee. There's countries like Norway which have already achieving, I think, an approaching 25% of new vehicle sales are now electric vehicle or hybrid. So there are significant steps forward. So yes, I admit the UK figures, indeed with Scotland within it, the take-up of electric vehicles is lower than I'd like it to be. and we clearly want to see a significant step forward in that over time. We need, obviously, a supportive UK policy environment for that in terms of fiscal incentives, and thankfully there is at least a fiscal incentive. We top that up, and I'll maybe check with colleagues exactly at the margin because I can't recall the figure, but there is a loan fund which is available to provide a very attractive rate of interest loan, but to help people. I think it's up to 35,000, but I maybe check with colleagues about that in terms of the cost of electric vehicle. So we actually help people with loan funds, but there's also support on top of that from UK government in terms of an incentive to reduce the overall price as well. So we are trying to help support increase in sales, and we have an aspiration to get more than 40% of sales by the end of, I think, 2030. So, I think that's not unrealistic given Norway's already into the 20s. We just need to have both a UK and certainly Scottish policy working in concert to achieve that. Hopefully, with the rollout of the rapid charging infrastructure as well, which is going very well, we can provide the infrastructure people need to be able to use that fleet with confidence and know that they've not got range anxiety about maybe not being able to complete their journey. That's largely with proven some battery technology becoming a thing of the past as well. So we'll see step forwards over this time period in the technology itself, so people have the confidence to be able to drive the similar sort of length of driving range as they do now with a fossil fuel car. By that timescale, I would anticipate big strides forward in battery technology, but we'll also have the infrastructure in place to support people where they need it to charge as well, and hopefully a supportive environment in terms of the cost of buying a vehicle or leasing a vehicle as well.
I wanted to ask you about decarbonising domestic heat. So obviously the objective is that by 2032, 80% of domestic heat will come from low carbon sources. But obviously we know at the moment 80% of households are using gas and only for heating, and only about 2% are getting their heat from lower carbon sources. And so with that objective, by 2032, you're sort of wanting that to effectively reverse that position. And so that's obviously really ambitious. So I was wondering if you could outline what you see as being the mix. So how much from electricity, how much from, say, you know, hydrogen in the gas supply, or zero heat homes, or how would you see it?
It's a very important question. Actually, it's probably one of the most important in there, because the general thrust of the draft energy strategy is largely to try and achieve the scale of ambition that we've delivered on electricity with heat. And over half our energy consumption at this moment in time, 54%, is heat. So it's a huge issue for us. So we do need to deploy, we recognise we need to deploy different technologies and different solutions in different areas of the country, and indeed Coventry Highlands and Islands yesterday, stakeholders there were saying that we need the flexibility to be able to deliver solutions that match our circumstances, building stock, the rurality of location, the access to infrastructure. Not everywhere has a gas grid to start with. So these are all inhibiting factors, so we have to come up with solutions. So in some cases it may be electrification of heat, where it's not already happening, so moving away from solid fuel perhaps to electrified heat. In other cases, it will be district heating solutions, and the consultation that both myself and Cathy have referred to around the regulation potentially of district heating market. I should say for the record for the committee that in interaction with industry, there's extremely strong interest in district heating in Scotland from investors. They see London and Scotland as the two places to go to in terms of the UK for investment in district heating. So there's the right combination of, I guess, in the case of London, the government there, and indeed in Scotland, government support for that. Regulatory environment is emerging, and so they've got some confidence that there's a appropriate sort of mechanism to help that happen, and potentially in Scotland's case at least very strong partnership with local government as well to make it happen. So I'm sure there's strong interest in COSLA in this agenda as well, but I just want to put on record there's strong investor interest in it too. So we can see probably substantial investment in district heating, but that will not cater for the majority of properties, so we need to be realistic about that. Hydrogen in the longer term has real potential to replace domestic natural gas. It's a real opportunity for oil and gas industry and other players to get involved in that. And that's one of the reasons why we've got so firmly a commitment in the energy strategy transit, you know, that the oil and gas industry have a role in the low carbon transition. They have the skill sets, the infrastructure, and in some cases the technology to support this, and the expertise in the case of natural gas. And I hadn't appreciated before this coming this role, and I don't want to overstate my youth because I'm clearly not as young as I used to be, but before I was even born, there used to be town gas which had hydrogen in it. So it has been used before in a domestic context in Scotland. And so it may have a rebirth in this role in providing an alternative to natural gas as a heating fuel. So we're certainly encouraging people to take part in the SEEP consultation around the energy efficiency aspects, but also the consultation that Cathy referred to around district heating and local heat and energy efficiency strategies is really important to help us get industry engagement and what sort of supportive environment you need to make that happen.
So, I mean, you mentioned district heating there, and one of the policies around that is the district heating loan fund. So that's where local authorities and housing associations can apply for money overseas. Is that mainly for retrofitting, or is that for new builds, or is it a combination?
I'm open to suggestions on that. I mean, certainly up to now it's largely been about retrofitting, but there are, I'm aware, some proposed projects where there's a mixture, maybe a new development happening adjacent. I've met one potential developer that was looking at us indeed where there was an existing development that might benefit from the rollout of a district heating package that could then benefit those other householders. So I've tried to encourage the industry to look at those opportunities where there are new builds and to design that in and to think about how they can actually benefit the existing community as a bit of a positive for a development happening in the area to get a positive benefit to them rather than just seeing a new housing estate plonk next to them and no benefit for the existing community. So I think there's a lot of upsides to that. So we're certainly not against that in any way, shape or form. Indeed, we'd encourage it. But I don't know whether Cathy's got any...
Because we heard that the loan fund, the take-up had been a bit lower than expected, and I was wondering what your comments would be as to why that was and if that is a concern going forward.
Well, we're certainly funding projects, innovative projects in this area under a number of different headings, and I think LCITP and the SEEP as well as District Heating Loan Fund, are all contributing to this. So it may well be that we're seeing more activity than is visible through the one particular fund, but I don't know whether either Sue or Cathy want to just comment on the other funds that are being used to promote energy efficiency projects and specifically district heating projects.
Innovative district heating is being funded under Low Carbon Infrastructure Transition Programme, as the Minister said. So we're seeing some kind of innovative schemes coming out of that, as well as sort of wider local energy systems funds going in. So I think that's probably the way for the future. When we're looking for innovation, we're not looking for the standard loans. We are looking largely towards grant programmes in the first instance and working towards commercial projects in the longer term.
I mean, I think the project I referred to earlier, the River Clyde Homes one, was funded under that route. Yeah. And as I say, tenants there that I spoke to in a period of 3 months prior to my visiting had a bill, it was very modest. It was around sort of £50 to £70 from memory was their entire heating bill for that 3 month period. And bearing in mind that was just before Christmas. Yeah. So, it was having, there were some very happy tenants, I can put it that way.
Okay, thank you.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to follow up on the point made that the energy strategy should be seen as part of a wider business and industrial strategy, which I agree with. Given this, can I ask the Minister why the Scottish Government is proposing significant rate increases for renewable projects and companies across Scotland? I understand Scottish Renewables has written to the Scottish Government highlighting concerns about the proposed increase to business rates. In some cases, the increase is fivefold and puts into jeopardy the commercial viability of some of the projects. Does the Minister agree or share those concerns expressed by Renewables Scotland?
Well, first thing to say is that the valuations that Mr. Lockhart refers to are set by the assessors, and I'm not denying there's an important issue here, so I'll come on to that, but just to make the point that the valuations that have been set are set by the assessors, and then where government comes in is in terms of relief schemes and in terms of setting the poundage, as I'm sure Mr. Lockhart knows. So what we do have is for community projects, ones which have significant community component, they benefit from a relief scheme on business rates, so they shouldn't be affected in the way that Mr. Lockhart describes. Clearly, very small projects which have a low rateable value will benefit from small business bonus as well, so there's that aspect. But I do appreciate that there have been some, in terms of the draft valuations that the assessors put forward, some significant, significantly higher valuations, and that's something that we have been engaging with Scottish Renewables and the industry on, and indeed feeding that into Mr. Mackay, and I know he is listening very carefully to those concerns, and hopefully will be able to address them in due course. So we are obviously encouraging any business, regardless of whether it's a renewables business or a wider in the wider economy, to take advantage of the appeal process that's available to them between when the finalised valuations are issued in the middle of March through to September, to take advantage of the ability to appeal to the assessor if they believe that they've been unfairly treated in terms of the valuation. And where estimates have been used by the assessor to reach a valuation, to be able to use actual data for their project, perhaps to be able to demonstrate that there's been an overvaluation of the asset. So I hope that there's a positive option there in terms of the appeal process that is already pre-exists, but there's also a hope that we'll demonstrate a listening government that's listening to the industry and will hopefully help to alleviate concerns in that area.
Just a follow-up. Given the large-scale sort of footprint of these projects, they tend to have a large area of coverage, and that makes them more likely to be covered by the large business supplement, given the bigger footprint. Do you think that's a fair tax on renewable companies to be subject to a tax which is effectively double the tax elsewhere in the UK?
Well, I mean, we should bear in mind that valuations and the process that we're going through is exactly the same as in the rest of the UK in terms of the assessor role of coming up with a valuation. As I say, there's a mechanism by which these can be challenged. I do know that meant obviously larger projects have larger sites, and I accept that. There's obviously likely to be a higher rateable value in that situation. But I think at the upper end, in terms of the larger sites, there's a smaller increase in the draft valuations than for the lower end of the spectrum. What we are trying to do over time, we set this out in the energy strategy, is also encourage developers to consider shared revenue models with the community and to engage with the community and make a genuine look at community ownership options, shared investment, and obviously government helps through REEF and CARES to help those communities to take forward those opportunities. And where that is possible, they become eligible for rates relief in terms of community becoming community projects. So there are different ways to attack this problem from the point of view of the developer, but we certainly encourage them to engage with the assessor, and I know the assessors quite often would be willing to meet informally with all businesses to discuss their concerns about valuation and hopefully address them without having to go through a formal appeal, which is obviously more expensive for the business. So I know from having been up in Aberdeenshire recently that the assessor there is very keen to engage with businesses informally, see if there's a way in which they can tackle the issue, and if not, then they've always got the right to go through appeal anyway. But we are looking very seriously at the issue about how rates interact with renewables, and indeed Ken Barclay's review, I've been encouraging the industry to feed into that review during the consultation to make sure any such issues were taken into account, because the objective of that exercise is to have a rates regime which is supportive of economic growth.
Richard Leonard.
Thanks. Just two very quick questions on the supply side, and I'll go back to Ash Denham's question about the 80% to 80% switch, which is a fairly phenomenal change in heating sources. I mean, the depiction that's been presented to us by witnesses in previous sessions is that you seem to be jogging between now and 2025 and sprinting flat out between 2025 and 2032. I mean, how on earth do you expect the low-carbon technologies industries to build the capacity and to have the skill sets to deal with that kind of schedule? Wouldn't it be better to have a reasonably average speed throughout the whole of the period?
Well, I recognise that challenge is always a challenge when looking at a long-term shift of something as significant as this. But we have to recognise that we have to give a signal and allow the capacity of the industry to build up. We can't expect them to go, if you're not using the Mr. Leonard's analogy, go immediately into sprint mode from day one, or at least a canter, if I can use a sort of a mixed speed model. we need to build up the capacity of the construction industry, the skilled trades, which have we've obviously had a huge contraction in many aspects of skilled trades during the housing recession from 2008 onwards, and that, you know, the industry is taking time to recover, investing in apprenticeships, investing in building up the skills that are required to roll out the technology, because if you were to rush your fences, if I can put it that way, mixing the cantering model here, you would end up in having inflationary pressures on some of the a limited industry to respond to growth at time, and that might make it less cost effective for us to roll out the technology. We've just touched upon with Mr. Whiteman, there's still a degree of developing the technology itself and demonstrating the technology, which is what we're doing through LCITP and SEEP funded projects, and that will help us to understand which technologies work best, most cost effective, and have the biggest impact on the household in terms of saving the money and saving climate emissions. So I think it's not unrealistic to expect we're going to take a few years before we get up to a position where we've got a steady state industry that can really go on at pace to scale the walls and get us over the target. But we do have to give a signal, strong signal, for the reasons we touched upon earlier on with Jackie Bailey, around some aspects of society as well, whether it's private landlords or private occupiers. We need to give them enough time to prepare for this and to know that there's a long time scale for which they can achieve the objectives.
Do you have any forum where you sit down with the industry and the industry's trade unions to plan the implementation of such a transformational change?
Well, we do engage with trade unions and industry, probably not in the way that Mr. Leonard describes, but you know we're open to doing that. Certainly, we need to understand the skills aspect, not just from the college sector perspective, but from trade unions and workforce perspective. I've given a commitment to Mr. Leonard in the past in the chamber that what we want to do is honour a commitment we gave during the 2009 Act, when neither Mr. Leonard or I were here in this chamber, but to society, that we take them with us on a journey and we don't break the economy in the process of making the transition low carbon, and we have to obviously help employees in the high carbon areas of the economy to transition to low carbon. So through the likes of the Transition Training Fund in the oil and gas industry, we are providing training opportunities for people to retrain in fitting smart meters for the electricity system, and also to help people get new skills to be apprentices or to be employed in these sort of areas. So I think I appreciate the point that Richard Lyon is making, and in an ideal world it'd be nice to have a sort of smoother trajectory. I appreciate that, but we have a capacity issue to overcome first, so we can't expect the industry to respond very quickly immediately, and we've also got to allow time for the regulation and other aspects to emerge as well and to be put in place to help drive the market and to allow COSLA and other partners to develop the strategies at a local level as well.
Well, can I have just one very quick question coming on a different subject? Minister, at the weekend, CS Wind UK announced that they were planning to make 60 people redundant from the plant at Macrahanish. Have you spoken to the company, or do you have any intention of taking any action?
Yes, so I've spoken with the company on a number of occasions. Indeed, they were in my office last week in Parliament, and we were trying to identify any ways in which we could prevent the job losses. Sadly, I do believe the company has a future, and it will have a sustainable future. There is a short-term issue that they have had with the sudden changes in policy position in terms of onshore wind, which have dried up to some extent the onshore wind market. And also the offshore wind market, which is emerging, where it is proving challenging for supply chain companies to be cost competitive in the context of a CFD auction process, where a developer can lose a bid on the basis of 1 pence per megawatt hour, which is, in my view, a crazy system to do it. Should be more account taken of the supply chain impact on the economy. But we're encouraging UK ministers to be more expansive in that area. But we will work, I assure Mr. Leonard, that we'll work very closely with CS Wind in terms of identifying anything the government in Scotland can do to help them, including looking at how we can support the supply chain, support innovation, so that we can help the company become more cost competitive with yards in places like Spain, where they have significantly more or less state aid considerations in terms of the very high levels of unemployment in Spain. There's a stronger market argument, if you like, for intervention in Spain. gain than that we can possibly make in the context of a relatively tight labour market in Scotland. But we are working with, that's not my view, that's just the view of the state aid environment, I should stress. But we are, I assure Mr. Leonard, working very closely with the company as we speak to try and help them and to ensure we will support the workforce as well, which is obviously very important to the Argyll economy.
Right, well, I will thank the Minister very much for coming into committee today
thank you.
Also our other guests, and I'll close the public session at that point. Thank you.